All right, so now the shaman are very strange people. And it's very difficult to know how long archaic people have been practicing shamanic rituals, but we know that it's tens of thousands of years. And we also know that most of the shamanic rituals and the visions that accompany them are induced by some kind of hallucinogenic substance. And it depends, like it depends on the culture what the hallucinogenic substance is. But one of the things that's quite interesting about them is that they all have basically the same chemical structure. And I'll show you that in a minute. So in the shaman, people who are chosen to be shaman are basically, you might think of them as the repositories of the oral tradition of the culture. You know, because most cultures have, for it to be a culture, first of all, if it's a culture and it's living, it's been around for a tremendous amount of time. You know, and non-literate cultures have to carry the wisdom that they have with them in oral form or in embodied form, so in ritual form or in oral form, and somebody has to be the fundamental repository of that kind of wisdom, so the sort of the storyteller of the tribe and the keeper of the flame, so to speak, and that's usually the role that the shaman have, and they're the people who are contacted when something's gone wrong with you. If you're sick, or if, you know, you're having real trouble mediating with another tribe member, someone like that, or you know, when you're maybe overcome with awe because you're looking at the night sky, you know, it's the shaman who's supposed to be dealing with the realities that are outside of day-to-day reality. And so they're like masters of sacred space. That's one way of thinking about it. And sometimes they're that way because their father was a shaman, or maybe their mother, and sometimes it's because they're kind of peculiar, you know, they're people who are visionary as part of their temperament. And we know that visionariness, so to speak, is an element of temperament. It's associated with trait openness, and that's associated partly with intelligence, but also partly with creativity, and those things aren't exactly the same. So some people are more imaginative and visionary than others, and in our culture, those would be people who tell great stories, like J.K. Rowling is a really good example of that, because she's been a shamanic intermediary for a, you know, for an entire generation of young people with these massive books that she's written that, you know, have a mythological core right down to their essence. And Stan Lee, who ran Marvel Comics, is another person like that, you know, who's had an immense cultural influence because he's brought these ancient stories back up from the depths and put them into modern form. You know, and the writers of these things are quite consciously aware of what they're doing with regards to the relationship with the underlying myths. They're not stupid people. And even if they were, their readership rapidly informs them if they're deviating from the, you know, proper narrative arc of the story. Because all those superheroes have their, you know, dedicated cults of followers, and they make bloody sure that the new writers don't mess around with the story. And so not only is it top-down from the writers, but it's also bottom-up from the readers. So they're all participating in the construction of a continuing cultural apparatus. So spontaneous vocation, well, you're sort of designed for it. Hereditary transmission, well, you know, it's a familial issue. And then there's the personal quest issue, too. So, you know, that's sort of associated with spontaneous vocation. So, and the personal quest element would be, there's always people in every culture who are fundamentally obsessed with the pursuit of meaning. You know, that's their essential orientation towards life. They're not particularly practical, like a conscientious person would be, because a conscientious person works, you know, and their head isn't in the clouds, but there are types of people who are not like that at all. Their heads are in the clouds permanently, and you know, they're extraordinarily imaginative and creative, and they're thought leaders in many ways for the culture, because a lot of what cultures learn in an articulated sense, a lot of what they become conscious of, is presented to them by artists in somewhat unconscious form long before the full meaning of what's being portrayed is articulated. Just like that, you know, I just showed you that tree image with Mary and the church, you know, on either side of it. It's not like the person who drew that knew what they were doing. They knew more about what they were doing than the people who couldn't draw that sort of thing. But they were existing on the edge of their knowledge, making this representation, thinking, I'm trying to get at something here, I'm trying to get at something here. But they didn't really know what it was, because the idea is so complex that, you know, when people have are coming up with it over these thousands of year periods, they don't realize the full import of what it is that they're revealing. I mean, just as you don't realize your own full import. By whatever, this is from Mircea Eliade, by whatever method he may have been designated, a shaman is recognized as such only after having received two methods of instruction. The first is ecstatic, dreams, trances, visions. The second is traditional shamanic techniques, names and functions of the spirits, mythology and genealogy of the clan, and secret language. The twofold teaching imparted by the spirits and the old master shaman constitutes initiation. And so that's a very interesting representation of the manner in which personal revelation becomes knowledge. So, you know, let's say, you know, you're beset by a very frightful series of nightmares. I mean, what that's going to do is to drive you to try to understand how to represent what you're having nightmares about in terms of the cultural elements that you have at hand. Because that's what makes you sane, you know. If you're having experiences that are beyond the norm, unless you can incorporate them back into your culture, you're alienated from your culture, and that's a terrifying thing. It means, like, you might be the only person that's insane like you. And, you know, that's very intolerable for people. It's bad enough to be different, but to be so different that you're incomprehensible, it's like, to you, that's the sort of horror you don't want to encounter. So the shaman are people who are possessed by, like, a rich inner fantasy life, but who are simultaneously capable of taking that and weaving it into the cultural mythology that they're part of. That's what makes them sane rather than insane, right? Because a schizophrenic is someone who has visionary experience, although it's often auditory. You know, they hear voices and they're possessed by spirits in a sense. You see them wandering down the street, you know, muttering to their own internal voices, but they can't integrate any of that with the culture, so they're gone, like they're lost souls. So the shaman is someone who does both, you know, who has the visions, but who incorporate it at the same time. So he's someone who's master of the visions and not victim of them. And so there's technologies that allow people to do that. And a lot of them are associated, as I said before, with the use of various hallucinogenic substances. In Siberia, the youth who is called to be a shaman attracts attention by his strange behavior. For example, he seeks solitude, becomes absent-minded, loves to roam in the woods or unfrequented places, has visions, and sings in his sleep. In some instances, this period of incubation is marked by quite serious symptoms. Among the Yakuts, the young man sometimes has fits of fury and easily loses consciousness, hides in the forest, feeds on the bark of trees, throws himself into water and fire, and cuts himself with knives. So those are ordeals, in a sense, you know. A future shaman among the Tungus, as they approach maturity, go through a hysterical or hysteroid crisis, but sometimes their vocation manifests itself at an earlier age. The boy runs away into the mountains and remains there for a week or more, feeding on animals, which he tears to pieces with his teeth. He returns to the village filthy and bloodstained, and it's only after 10 or more days have passed that he begins to babble incoherent words. So you'd think, from the perspective of modern human beings, that this is something like descent into the unconscious structures that underlie normative cognition, just like you descend into that at night when you dream. It's a very peculiar process that you're all perfectly capable of engaging in, but most of you have virtually no control over it. I mean, there are people who dream lucidly, you know, and who can exert some conscious control over their dreams. Most people can learn how to do that to some degree, but in our culture, at least, most people dream unconsciously, and it's just something that happens to you and not something that you're actively engaged with. A strange behavior of future shaman have not failed to attract the attention of scholars. And from the middle of the past century, by which he meant the 19th century, several attempts have been made to explain the phenomenon of shamanism as a mental disorder. But the problem is wrongly put. For on the one hand, it's not true that shamans always have to be neuropathics or neurotics or people who are not well put together mentally. On the other hand, those among them who had been ill became shaman precisely because they had succeeded in becoming cured. So what that means is these are people who've undergone some kind of existential crisis, sometimes one that's induced, you know, as part of the process that turns them into shaman, but they were able to undergo that existential crisis and then put themselves back together. And so that's what makes them masters of the chaotic realm, so to speak. And so if you're starting to fall apart and you don't know what to do, well, the best thing you can possibly do is find someone who's been there and come back. And that idea of going somewhere and coming back is also a very, very common mythological story. So that's the story of the Hobbit, for example, right? Because the Hobbit goes off on this quest, and he undergoes all sorts of trials, and he encounters the dragon that lives underneath everything, and he gets the gold from the dragon, which is the information that the dragon stores. And then he comes back to his community, and he's transformed. But he's strange. Like, he's going off on this big adventure, and now he's, like, well put together and tough, and he's also rich. But he's also peculiar, you know. When Bilbo goes back to the Shire, you know, everybody no one's exactly sure what to do with him, because now he's contaminated with everything that he's gone through. So he's like an agent of chaos himself, you know, and someone who's somewhat terrifying. But, you know, useful if you have to have a consultation about how you might deal with the next dragon.
Clean up your room. Then you'll know what to do next. I had a girl come up to me last night. She said, I started cleaning up my room, and it completely changed my life. She said, your room is an externalization of your mind. And that's right. That's exactly true.